Right now, I'd be in the presence of God.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen. And I know it, not because I'm a good guy, because he's a good God. He's a merciful God. Today, I wanted to talk about following the instruction plan. Following the instruction manual. If you have your Bible, turn to Psalm 119. This past week, I had the blessing of going to a camp in a place called Great Barrington. I never heard of it before. I knew where Barrington was, Rhode Island, but I'd never been to Great Barrington. It's down in the southwest corner of Massachusetts, in the Berkshires. I didn't even know it was in the Berkshires until I got there. But it was a camp last spring. Was it spring that Special Touch was here, Patty?
May.
In May, yeah. We had a group from Special Touch, Kim Ferguson. It's a ministry to folks with physical and cognizant disabilities. And they have chapters around Massachusetts where they meet, you know, for bowl-a-thons and different things. There is a large population of disabled folks in America who Jesus loves. And so this camp was not just about a place for everyone to come and minister to them, but it really was a place where they got to minister. They came and they had caregivers, and they got to, we had a talent show, and we had all kinds of wall rock climbing, you know, and archery, and all kinds of things for folks. And I built a little worship team during the week. I had a harmonica player, I had a drummer, I had a couple of singers, I had even a saxophone player. And by the end of the week, we were making a joyful noise to the Lord there. So, but one of the things that really touched my heart, a lot of things touched my heart, was a story that a woman told about her children. She has children that, you know, have different autism and different things. And they found a little bird in their yard, and had fallen out of the tree. Newborn baby bird, and they live up in New Hampshire in the wooded area. And the crows were coming down and, you know, trying to kill it. And they shoot away the crows, and they found it, and it had no feathers. It had pock marks from the crows, you know, pecking at it. And they put it in a little box, and they thought it wasn't going to make it. But she started to feed it. She read online how that the stuff that's in puppy food, soft puppy food, is the same stuff that is worms and same stuff. We don't like to think of it that way, but it's basically protein, and worms and bugs are same chemical compound. So she started feeding this little bird with a toothpick, just a little tip of a toothpick. And she said that the mouth was like, couldn't open, so she squeezed him out, and then she thought she crushed his head and all these things. But she was teaching her children to feed this little bird. And soon he revived, and he would get up out of the box and stand on the box. And soon he became like a family pet. He was, you know, flying around and landing on people's shoulders and like this. So one day they got up and they named him Christopher. And Christopher had flew the coop and gotten out. And they were concerned because he hadn't been assimilated to the wild, still eating food that they were providing for it. So they start praying, and they went outside, and they called Christopher, Christopher. She said she was out there doing the laundry, and she was calling Christopher, and she saw him over the trees. Came the bird, landed first on the shed, and then down to the line, and then jumped on her shoulder. And he was still willing to eat what she gave her. And for a long time ago, for a long season, they would go outside and they would call Christopher, Christopher, and here he would come. He'd just come and land in it. It was like the talk of all the neighbors, you know, the people that had a pet wild bird comes when they call him. And the day came when Christopher would no longer accept food because he had assimilated into the wild. And of course, over time, Christopher didn't come anymore, kind of went on with his life. Nobody knows what happened to him, but it was just such a powerful story, a testimony of kindness. You know, the Bible says that God feeds the birds of the air. And in this instance, he used this family who didn't find a dead bird on their lawn and say, that's a dead bird, tossing in the trash. But they extended kindness and tenderness, and this bird was revived. And out of it, they were rewarded with this wonderful life experience in their life that's pretty not your normal everyday story of somebody with a bird. So just a rich thing, and it has served, they said, as a lesson to their children and a testimony in their lives. God has used it on multiple levels to teach them things about his love and his concern. I wanted to talk today about that a little bit, and we've been on the prophets, and we concluded that. But if you turn to Psalm 119, I want to talk about following the instruction manual, because God has, in his kindness and his love, he has given us a light and a lamp to light our path. He has not left us without an instruction manual, Bible. Some people said it's an acronym, basic instructions before leaving Earth. When Christmas comes, you get a toy, you know, and as a father, I always had things I had to put together, and they come with instructions. And me being a guy, I just throw them on the side and start putting the thing together. And about halfway through, I realized that this screw went there, and I find myself looking in the pile of trash for the instruction manual and saying, I should have started there to begin with. When you read Psalm 19, just some neat stuff. If your Bible has little markings, Psalm 19 is the longest chapter in the Bible, 150 verses. It's long. 176 verses. It's smack dab in the middle of your Bible. And it was written, and as you read it, it should be broken down into stanzas of 8 verses, isn't it? You see, my Bible says Aleph, the little designation Aleph.
Yeah.
And then, blessed are the undefiled in the way, verses 1 through 8. And then, Beth, verses 9 through 16. Well, this is an acrostic psalm. It was written that way which means that each section, each sentence, and each stanza begins with the letter of the Hebrew alphabet in Hebrew, like Aleph, Beth. So it's an acrostic, and it was written that way. It doesn't translate that way to English, because we see blessed, blessed who, they, you. Those are different English letters, but in the Hebrew, each sentence begins with the letter of the alphabet for that section. And so it was really intended to be something that could easily be put to memory. You could remember it that way, A, Aleph, and then each sentence begins with A. And these were songs that were sung. We read them as literature, but they were actually sung. They were put to music, and they became part of the songbook of ancient Israel. And so this is the ABCs, or the primer. And the topic of Psalm 119 is the Word of God. The Word of God talks about, verse 4, you have commanded us to keep your precepts, all that my ways were directed to keep your statutes. And so today we're going to look at verses 9. Start reading verse 9. Yes, a question. How can a young man, or how can a young woman cleanse his way? How do we make our way through this life? How can we make our way through this life? It's a crazy planet, isn't it? I used to preach a message called The Insanity of Living Without God. The Insanity of Living Without God. People live all over the planet without God in their lives. It is a dangerous planet. It is a planet. It is a place fraught with all kinds of perils and struggles and temptations. And we need the power and the presence of God in our lives to navigate through this life. How can a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed. Everybody say, take heed.
Take heed.
Let's put that in right down 2015, you know, on the street, Broadway English. Listen up. Listen up. Open up. Let me open up my ears. Let's put my catchers on, they used to say. It's time to listen. By taking heed, by paying attention, by listening to what? To the popular opinion of everybody around me? By listening to what they say on the news? How about listening to what politicians say? Is that what it says? By taking heed to your word. With my whole heart I have sought you. Do not let me wander from your commandments. Your word have I hidden in my heart so that I might not sin against you. Blessed are you, O Lord. Teach me your statutes. With my lips I have declared all the judgments of your mouth. I have rejoiced in the way of your testimony as much as in all riches. I will meditate on your precepts, I will contemplate your ways, and I will delight myself in your statutes. I will not forget your word. So he begins that stanza with saying, pay attention to the word, pay attention to the word. And then he responds by saying, I will pay attention, I will listen to your precepts, I will contemplate your ways. I will delight in your statutes. I will not forget your word. He said, You got my attention, God. I'm going to give my attention to the instruction man. Now, some people thought I was hungry today, but I have a cake box here. Cake box. Who likes Tevel food? Terrible name, but it's good cake. Devil's food cake. Has some instructions on here. Let's check them out. Set the oven to 350 degrees Fahrenheit for a metal or a glass pan. For dark coated pan, set oven to 325. Now that's what it tells me to do. Then it tells me to take brownie mix. There's brownie mix in here. But what if I just said, you know what? I don't want to use brownie mix. I'm just going to use sugar. Sugar's in cake. I'm just going to fill the bowl with 2 cups of sugar. It says oil. Now, oil, oil tastes nasty. Pancake syrup. I like pancake syrup. I'm going to pour pancake syrup into this. Yeah, that'll work just as good. Water. Water. Chocolate milk. Come on, some chocolate milk in this. You know, chocolate brownies. We put some chocolate milk in it. And eggs. Who wants eggs? I don't want eggs. What can we, anybody got a suggestion besides
Chipotle.
Eggs?
Chipotle.
Tomato sauce. There we go. We'll put tomato sauce in. A couple of pureed tomatoes. There we go. Stir it in. Spread it out in your pan. Who wants to eat my cake? Who wants a slice? Come on, it's a great birthday cake. It's like, what's happening? I gotta follow the instructions. If I don't follow the instructions, I'm not gonna get cake. I'll get something. I'll be able to eat it if I choose to, but it's not gonna be very good. You know, the Bible says that men choose their own ways and then their hearts rage against the Lord. Most of the time in my life when I've gotten into trouble, I have gotten into trouble because I wasn't following the instructions. I wasn't following the precepts, the plan of God. And oftentimes when things blow up in our face because we haven't followed the instructions, we sometimes blame God. We say, hey God, I'm doing this, I'm doing that, but you're not coming through, you're not coming across. But how many of you know we need to be consistently following the instruction manual, consistently following the instruction manual. So how do I do that? What are some simple ways that I can follow the instruction? Let's go to Psalm 1. Psalm 1, first Psalm. He's going to tell us some things that we need to eliminate from our lives. And then he's going to tell us some things that we need to do. How many of you know, I'm glad that Christianity is not just about don'ts. It's not a list of, you know, don'ts. There's certainly some things we shouldn't be doing if we're going to follow Jesus. Love God. Keep the commandments. Keep the commandments of God. If I love Jesus, I'm going to follow after him. He said, if a man loves me, he'll do what I say. You know, you can only do things for God out of fear for so long, out of terror. But if you love God, if you grow in your love for God, you find that it becomes simpler and easier to do what God's asked you to do because you love him, because you want to follow him, because you want to be with him. But I'm glad that it's not all a list of don'ts. Certainly there's some things we don't want to be doing. But there's some things we have to allow God to help us to incorporate into our lives, into our daily lives, on a consistent way, so that we can do what the psalmist said, what we read, take heed to his word, so that we can pay attention, so that we can get it in our hearts and let it be hidden in our hearts. Why? Because then we won't sin against the Lord, and we'll come back to that before we're done. how that happens. But first, we want to see, blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the ungodly. Number one, if you're going to walk in the ways of God and walk in the Word of God, you must put what God says first and pay attention to that, and put behind you what ungodly men and the philosophies of society and even the thoughts and ideas that we may have ourselves about what we should be doing. We have to be willing to put those behind us and not walk in the counsel, the advice, the direction of those who don't know the Lord. They may be well-meaning, they may have good intentions, they may not. But we need to be willing to not listen to the counsel of those who are going to give us advice and direction and suggestions that agree with, listen, what I want to do. Because if I'm going to walk in the plan of God and in the purpose of God, sometimes there are things I want to do that maybe God doesn't have for me. And it's easy to gather around ourselves a group of people that will tell us what we want to hear rather than hear the truth of what God wants to say. You know, well, I like you as long as you tell me what I want to hear and you agree with what I think I should be doing. That's right. That's right. You know, I was in a discussion group the other night. They were talking about the integration of psychology and Christianity, and some of the psychologists, and then they were talking about that. You know, since certain church leaders in the past respected certain philosophers like Aristotle and Socrates and all these guys. How many of you know these were men who were without God? They didn't know the Lord. They had some serious issues in their lives. These are the guys that Paul went to in Athens, and they were the philosophers and the big eggheads that had all of this information, but they didn't know God. And Paul didn't go there and say, hey, you know, teach me what you have and what is great, whether maybe we can just get along and collaborate here. No, he went to them and he preached the Word of God. He called them to repent and to turn to God from their empty ways of life. Well, these people were talking about ways that we could collaborate, the counsel, the psychotherapy of guys like Freud and different, and that they can agree somehow, they have something to say to us. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly. See, we have to make up our mind where we're getting our counsel from. If we're going to receive our counsel from the world and from their system and ideas of how to do things, we're going to be confused every time. But if we make up our mind that I'm going to take my counsel from the Word of God, this is my manual, this is the lamp under my feet, this is the light unto my path. I don't read this because God will get mad at me if I don't. I read it because I need what it has to say. I need its wisdom. I need its counsel. I need its direction. And I'm not going to get it if I don't take heed and pay attention to it. So number one. Number two, nor stands in the path of sinners. You want to keep from temptation? It's kind of simple. Don't be hanging out where temptation is going to hit you.
That's right. Amen.
When I first got saved, it was years before I went back to the neighborhood I used to hang out in. Yeah. It was years. I don't hang out in bars. Why? Because I'm not going to tempt myself and tempt the Lord. Oh, but you can go in there and tell them about Jesus. I can wait till they can come out and tell them about Jesus. I don't got to go in and hang out in the bar.
Come on.
If I want to fight a good warfare, I've got to fight it from my strongest vantage point, not from my weakest. And God wants me to not stand in the path. That means to walk. In order to walk with people, you have to be in some degree of agreement. If you and me want to go to the store, we'll go together, we have to be going to the same store. If you're going this way and I'm going that way, we can't walk together. I may like you, I have nothing against you, but we're going in different ways. Two cannot walk together unless they be in what? Agreement. That means they got to be going the same way, following the same path, following after the same things, the same vision, and that's the counsel of the Word of God. Nor sits at the seat of the scornful. Another translation says, sits among the mockers.
Come on.
What are mockers? Who do they think? Who do they? These are folks that know more than seven men who have wisdom. These are men who have all the answers in themselves. And you'll find them in on any bar stool in America. You'll find them on any corner. You'll find them all over the place. People that just think they have all the answers. They just and they receive counsel from no one.
No.
You want to make a decision about who you're going to walk with and follow counsel from? Watch their life for a little while. See where their life is going. See how their life is turning out. And if it's turning, if that doesn't mean they have to be perfect. They may experience tragedy in their life. But if they're following after the Lord, and you can see the progressive direction of their life, you may have some people that you can walk with. Because they've been some places that maybe you haven't been, and they have something to share with you when times get rough for you that'll say to you not to mock or scoff or become bitter and talk trash, but they're going to speak the Word of God. They're going to encourage you in your walk. You can find people talking trash anywhere, anytime. Words are cheap. Words are cheap. But let's look at what he says we should do. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night. Now, sometimes when I used to read that when I first got saved and as I was growing, I used to think to myself, how do you do that? Meditate in the Word day and night. I'm not a monk, you know. I'm not eating in a cave eating lychee nuts, you know, with the incense going. I'm not a cleric, you know. It means, again, with the same concept right here, not to soon forget that when God shows you something and you get a piece of truth, or you hear things, or you come to church and a word, you hear a word that speaks to your heart, that when you leave, when you go on with your life, you don't allow it to soon just leave you, but you hold on to it, you consider it, you digest it, you chew on it for a while, and allow it to get deep down into your heart. Meditate on it. Meditate means to think over again, to remind yourself and to allow it to get down into your innermost being. Innermost being. His delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night. Can I say to you, if the only word of God you ever read is when you come to church, you're starving to death spiritually. You need to be in the Word. He shall be like a tree planted.
Plant.
By the rivers of water that brings forth its fruit in its season. Can I say this to you? God wants us planted in His Word. He wants us planted in His love. And He wants us planted in His church. He wants us planted. He wants our roots to go down deep. Paul says in Ephesians that we're not, God doesn't want us to be blown around by the winds and the cunning of man and winds of doctrine and this and that. But he wants us to be planted deep in the soil of the Word of God and in the heart of Jesus, so that when the trials come, and they will come, we're not going to be blown over, torn up, destroyed. It says, he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that brings forth its fruit in its season. I used to have a friend. He was a big, his name was Bob. He was as tall as my brother, but he was as big as a house. He used to be a motorcycle guy, and he was in the Teen Challenge program. And we were going out to an outreach, and we stopped to get gas for the generator, and we were at the island putting the gas in the can. And we had t-shirts on that year. They were white t-shirts with bright red letters, "The blood of Jesus destroys Satan, sin, demons," you know. And so the gas station attendant came out and he said to Bob, and started pointing in his chest, kind of being aggressive, "That's a fairy tale." And he kept doing it, trying to provoke him. Now, Bob was so large, he would get down on one knee at my desk and his head would be even with mine. He was a giant guy. You don't want to take a roundhouse kick from Bob. He was huge. He was huge. And we got back in the van and we were driving away and he said, "Brother Chuck, I know God's doing a work in my life. It's bringing fruit." You know why? Because 4 months ago, if he'd have done that, I'd have tore him apart.
Hallelujah.
See, the Word of God has the power. Listen,
yes.
when we tend to it and we allow it to get into our hearts, sometimes we don't feel like we're growing very much. Sometimes we don't feel like that anything's happening. But over time, that seed takes root. It has the power to fulfill itself. You don't have to fulfill it. It has the power, it has life in itself to bring about the desired result that God wants it to bring. And you'll find yourself in circumstances and in the middle of this, and you'll find yourself, the Word of God will begin to come to you. The wisdom of what to do, the direction of what to go. And it's not always, reams of verses that come to you. It's just a simple truth that will come to you. Something that the Holy Ghost will remind you because it's been planted. "Thy word have I hid in my heart," why? "That I might not sin against you." I may not go a different way than you want me to go. See, sin is not just doing bad things. The context of sin is missing the mark. Missing the direction that God wants me to go in. And the Word of God has the power to come up in me and to help me from within to begin to fulfill and to walk in the plan of God from the inside out. Yeah. Not something that I put on from the outside in, but it's something that begins to come. I begin to want to. I begin to delight after the counsels of God.
Hallelujah.
"His leaf also will not wither, and whatever he does shall prosper. The ungodly are not so, but are like chaff which the wind drives away." I don't want my life to be blown away in the chaff like chaff. I don't want to spend my life chasing after the wind and chasing after this and that. I want my life So do you. You want your life built on the Word, on the rock of the Word. It's really that simple. It's as simple as a child's prime. Simple as ABCs. I hear the Word. I pay attention to it. Don't listen to conflicting voices that will stop me from hearing the Word of God. Silence them. Don't walk in places that are going to cause me to be compromised or put me in a place of temptation that I can't handle. Listen to the counsel of godly people. Listen to the counsel of those who that I can see plainly are walking in this thing. And then as I do and meditate on the Word, it's going to bear fruit in my life. I don't have to worry about it. It's just going to do what God intended for it to do. It will take care of itself. And I'll find myself walking. I'll find myself walking in the counsel and the plan of God for my life. And I'll be glad I did. I was with some people this week. I haven't cried so much in my life. Tears of just joy. Tears of... My heart was just softened. I was reminded of some things. We had a talent show, and there are women with people up there just praising God. The reality of Jesus in our lives, through acts of kindness, through acts of, and it all comes because of the Word of God. He's faithful to His Word. He keeps His Word. He may, other people may not keep their Word or be faithful to the Word, but God. And it will be there for you when you face difficult things. While I was there, I got to share a little bit each day. And I was sharing with them about Brother Paul. I was sharing with them about some of the things that he's been experiencing. But I was glad I was able to share that here's a brother that has gone through a valley in his life. But yet as I sat next to his bed, he said to me, "It's all right. I know the Lord has my life in His hands."
Amen.
Rather than his heart raging against God and saying, "Where was God? And look, I bargained for all this, and how come?" And look, and there are those struggles in the dark hours of night where we say, "Oh God, why is this happening to me?" But where you come out on the other side and you say, "I know that the Lord is good. I know that He has been faithful to me,
yes.
And I know that even in this is not." That I am more than the sum of my parts. I am more than my ability or inability to do anything. You are more than the physical body that's sitting in that chair. But you are something that a treasure that's been created in the image and likeness of God.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
You are His treasure. And His Word is our mat, our guide through this thing, this place that we live on, this planet we live on. We're not fully in the kingdom yet. We get a taste, a glimpse of the kingdom. We experience His presence. We experience His power. It's but a taste of what's to come. And it's the Word that's going to take us there. His word. Just begin to thank God.
Thank
Him for His word. Begin to thank Him. Begin to rejoice. Thank Him for His intervention in your life. Thank Him for His counsel, His guidance. Thank Him that He is fulfilling His plan in your life. Thank Him for His faithfulness. Just thank Him. Rejoice in it. Just say, God, I thank You, God. I thank You, Father God. Lord, we thank You, Lord, for Your word. We thank You for preserving it for us. We thank You, God, that it is a lamp unto our feet, a light unto our back. God, we may not be what we once be, but we're not what we once were. God, You are doing a work in our lives. You are doing a work in our lives. Help us to take heed and to pay attention and to allow more of Your word to get into our hearts, Lord. Hallelujah.
Where You go, I'll go. Where You stay, I'll stay. When You move, I'll move. I will follow. All Your ways are good. All Your ways are sure. I will trust in You alone. Higher than my sight, high above my life. I will trust in You.